Hello again, everyone. Welcome to our recorded worship service here at Manor House. And may the grace and peace of God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Today is the first Sunday of Lent, the holy season of Lent. And usually on that Sunday, the gospel lesson is always about Jesus' temptation in the desert. I'm not going to be preaching from that today. I'm going to be focusing on the epistles. Of the New Testament for this time of Lent. But let's remember that a temptation in the desert, it's always important with our prayer for today, our collect. So please join me in prayer. Almighty God, whose blessed Son was led by the Spirit to be tempted by Satan, come quickly to help us who are assaulted by many temptations. And as you know the weaknesses of each of us, let each one find you mighty to save. Through Christ, our Lord, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Remembering the great work of Jesus in this song, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Good song. Remembering that Jesus came, the righteous for the unrighteous, to save us and reconcile us to God, as Peter will remind us today. Mindful of our sins, let's join in the penitential psalm 32 today. Pray with me. Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord counts no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. For when I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Many are the sorrows of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds the one who trusts in the Lord. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. Thanks be to God. Amen. One of these days, I'm going to do a sermon on the wicked and the righteous, what the Bible means when it talks about that. Because that psalm makes it clear, we all know we sin, and none of us are righteous, but the Bible calls those who confess their sins and acknowledge their sin to God the righteous, because God receives that and forgives that and declares you righteous. And we Christians know the blood of Jesus cleanses us from our sin. The wicked really simply seem to be those who refuse to acknowledge their sin and confess it to God. So thanks be to God, He's enabled us to confess our sins and receive His grace and mercy. Now we're going to hear from the Apostle Peter today. In coming weeks, we'll hear from the letter of Romans and Corinthians and Hebrews and Ephesians. I'm going to be looking at a variety of the epistles throughout Lent. And here's what Peter writes to the early church in chapter 3. Now, who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is right? But even if you do suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled, but in your heart reverence Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to make a defense to anyone who calls you to account for the hope that is in you. Yet, do it with gentleness and reverence, and keep your conscience clear, so that when you are abused, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing right, if that should be God's will, than for doing wrong. For Christ also died for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So Peter talks about suffering here, and that is certainly a theme that we run into quite a lot in the New Testament. That is, following Christ entails in some way suffering for him. It's not one of the parts of our faith that we like to think about or dwell on, but it's there. It may not be preached in pulpits very much or taught. You certainly won't see it in the big TV churches where everything's about God wants to give you this and bless you with that. You know, they don't talk much about suffering for Christ. But it sure is in the New Testament. It sure is there very clearly. And suffering as a Christian is a constant theme in this first letter of Peter. It keeps popping up throughout the letter. We're in chapter 3, but it pops up everywhere, even in the midst of some of Peter's passages where he is reminding the people of some of the most glorious and wonderful of amazing, thrilling promises of God that he has for us, such as this, where he says, by his great mercy, we've been born anew into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. How magnificent this is, who by God's power are guarded through faith for a salvation to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice. Now, that's all fine. And I often read this text when I'm visiting someone in hospital or someone who's in serious crisis, one of our residents, and I want to encourage them with the wonderful promises. But I don't go on to this next part, which Peter has for us Christians out living in the world still. He says, in this you rejoice, though now for a little while you may have to suffer various trials so that the genuineness of your faith will be tested. You know, my residents I visit in the hospital of suffering, they don't need to hear about the suffering. And they're drawing near to an end of their suffering. They need to hear the promises, and that's what I stick with them. But the rest of us who are here laboring in the world, Peter is careful to remind that your life as a Christian in the world is going to have that. He has it there, and there are many other references to it throughout the letter, as in our text today. I just want to ask us, can we relate to that? Can we relate to that suffering as a Christian, as citizens of what may very well be the most prosperous, most secure, most free, most tolerant society that has ever existed? Just ignore what you're hearing about how America's, you know, just a terrible, racist, horrible country. I mean, just ignore all that. That's just nonsense. This is one of the greatest countries and freest and most prosperous that's ever been. Can we relate to it in a country like that? I mean, we certainly hear of Christians who live in much less civilized and secure places in the world being persecuted, even martyred for their faith quite often. But here in America, in Europe, at first we'd say, no, we don't really suffer. You know, we're not really suffering as Christians. But I believe Peter is referring here to a kind of suffering that may not be physical and, actual injury and imprisonment and execution and things, but as a kind of suffering that every real believer is going to experience to some degree or another. And it was true then in the first century when he was writing to his people there, first century Roman Empire, and it's true in the 21st century Western culture empire in ways that are a little bit different, but also rather similar too. Now, we all know, of course, from history and from movies and books, etc., that about the Roman persecutions of Christians in the empire and the famous stories of the entertainment spectacle in the Colosseum where they brought in Romans and throwing the Christians to the lions and all of that, of course. And I think for a long time, as we read the New Testament and the writers talk about suffering and persecution, we immediately in our minds go to that and think that's what they're referring to. And we assume it's a kind of an official Roman persecution policy against Christians here, like a kind of a genocide against Christians, such as is happening in China now against these Uyghur people, the minority, the ethnic minority there who's in concentration camps in China. But you know, there really isn't a lot of evidence for that in the letter itself, that it's an official Roman policy or something. And the examples and guidance that Peter gives, they make sense just in an ordinary, everyday way. They don't really need a government policy to make sense. Instead, they're the kind of things you're going to expect, really, if you're following a path in your life and your values and your beliefs. They're going to put you kind of out of sync with many of your fellow citizens, even perhaps your friends and family. Let's not forget what Jesus himself says in Matthew and Luke. Do not think I have come to bring peace on earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and a man's foes will be those of his own household. I think we all are aware that that kind of thing can happen when disagreements about faith come in. Your most intimate, important relationships coming under strain or even fractured, that sounds like suffering to me. And there's no official policy or anything needed for that to take place. Now, that's a great tragedy when it happens. What's more common, I think, is as Christians, we will find ourselves often simply unable to enter into approval or participation of a wide range of activities or policies or beliefs or practices that are quite common among our fellow citizens. And we may find ourselves challenged on that unwillingness to participate or approve, and in some cases, perhaps made to suffer for it. In chapter 4, one of the examples that Peter has here of his many references to suffering, he says this: don't do what the Gentiles do, living in licentiousness and passions, drunkenness, revels, carousing, and idolatry. They're surprised that you do not join them in the same wild profligacy, that's an old word, profligacy, and they abuse you, but they will give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. In other words, what's the matter? Why don't you do this? Or why do you think that's wrong? Well, I think it's wrong. It's against the Bible. It's against my understanding of God's word. It's against my, who are you to judge? You know, you hear things like that all the time. My one son has a good friend who's a Muslim boy. He's not a radical Muslim. He's just a devout Muslim, believing Muslim. Seems to be a very nice young man. I haven't met him. My wife has met him. And he's in his mid-20s. He's looking for a partner. You know, he's looking for a life partner. And I'm not sure that he's determined to marry a Muslim girl. He's a fairly secular-minded person, but he is a Muslim in his beliefs. And what he has told my son is, if he goes out with a girl, and immediately, pretty quickly, they're going to find out that he holds to traditional views about marriage and gender and sexuality, and does not affirm things like transgenderism or whatever thing, and all these same-sex marriage and things like this, the girl is immediately wants nothing to do with him. He finds this happening again and again, right? That there's a violation of her values, which are becoming more and more the values of the world, and he is once again rejected. That's no fun for a young man, is it? That's not any fun at all, being rejected, wondering, am I going to find anybody? That's a kind of suffering. That's a kind of gentle suffering there. You don't fit something. You're out of sync. If it's happening for him, it's happening for Christians as well. Now, when we're challenged in that way, what are we to do? Peter's pretty clear and says this: in your heart, reverence Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an account for the hope that is in you, but do it with gentleness and reverence. That is, even though you feel you are being abused or treated unfairly, just because you hold the beliefs that are different, remain calm and respectful and give your testimony. That's not easy. That's not easy. Especially when you try to do your best and it's rejected again. People's natural tendency is to want to avoid suffering, isn't it? To want to resolve this tension. And what do I need to do to not have this happen, this tension with my fellow citizens and friends? And one way is to start to just simply accommodate the culture and keep all those things hidden away and confine your Christianity and your faith to parts of it that are nobody finds offensive at all, which would be maybe, you know, works of mercy and kindness. You want to stay away from hard moral absolutes. You want to stay away from the notion of sin. You want to stay away from the notion of redemption or God's justice or anything. This is all very, very foreign-minded to people. And many people get really even infuriated at the idea that there are, in fact, eternal moral truths and principles that are not defined by human beings, right? That are God's truth, that are given to us and are not ours to pick and choose from. That infuriates some people. And if you're suffering a whole lot from that, well, you may just want to avoid going there altogether. Now, you might wind up getting along with them a little better until the next time they present you with something that they insist that you accept because it's their right that they are demanding, or they've just suddenly, everybody knows this is what we're supposed to think now. You might get along with them better, but you certainly won't be suffering as a Christian for Christ the way Peter is talking. You won't be taking up your cross and sharing in the suffering of Christ, who, let's not forget, himself came to suffer and die and confront the evil powers of the world on our behalf for us. And when we enter into him, we participate in that in some way. If we don't do that in order to maintain peace and avoid conflict, we may get our reward now, as Jesus says, but it will be from men and not from God. A Christian stands with the Christ who is one and only, the one and only. He is once for all. His word, his purposes do not change, even though the culture around us, like every culture, is in a constant state of change and adaptation and evolution with respect to technology, values, everything, constantly changing. Anyone who is going to affirm and remain faithful to divinely revealed eternal truths, which again, do not change, will always find themselves at some point or other standing in tension and opposition to the prevailing powers and values that are ascendant in whatever the contemporary culture is. Yes, that is going to involve some discomfort at times, at the very least. But in his letter, Peter continues on and is very, very careful to remind us that in the midst of that discomfort, we lift up Christ as Lord and remember. And remember that he has gone into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God with angels, authorities, and powers subject to him. Yes, Christ came to achieve our salvation. It involved as horrible suffering for him as any human being has had to ever endure. He never wavered. He bore it all. To the cross and through the cross. Through the cross to the empty tomb, to the exalted throne of God. That is the one we are faithful to. The cultures are going to come and go. Values are going to change. His word and truth remains fixed and eternal. And when you are in him, we are secure and safe eternally. In the world, we'll have trouble, but fear not. He has overcome the world. Thanks be to God. Amen. And we pray, let us pray. We thank you, Lord, that your word and truth, you in your teaching, your prophets, your apostles, do not candy coat or sugar coat the truth for us. They acknowledge very clearly what it is like to follow you in the world, and that, as the psalm reminds us, there are those who refuse to acknowledge your sovereignty, your holiness, who refuse to acknowledge their need for your forgiveness. You refer to them as the wicked. They may look very normal and be very nice people in most ways, but they are keeping themselves separate from you, and therefore their thoughts and ideas and values and decisions may be very much at variance with ours. And living in the world with such a variety of people, many of whom are controlling levers of power and have great influence over our lives, can be a great burden for us all. So during this time of Lent and at all times, we're grateful to have your word to encourage us and build us up and remind us of who we are. We're grateful for all the ways you gather us together and reconstitute us as your people, such as even this on a little video that we're able to gather together and remember that as the world comes and goes, you remain the same and we belong to you. And as Peter says, the inheritance that you have for us is imperishable and unfading, kept in heaven, far above all earthly power and authority, where you are seated at the right hand of God. That's why we are people of hope, and we give you all the thanks and praise for that, O Lord. We have much to be thankful for. As well, this Lord, we've gone through a difficult year with all kinds of various kinds of suffering that have not much to do with our spiritual life, but have been very, very real in the physical, social realm. And now we are seeing some light at the end of the tunnel. We are very grateful for that. As some moving into slightly less restricted activities for our residents, even in our Willowbrook Court, I want to praise you and thank you that I am so much looking forward to conducting some form of a worship service soon in Willowbrook Court, now that we are permitted to have small group gatherings. It's been almost a year since that has happened. I'm full of praise for that, and I give you thanks for that. So we pray for our progress to continue apace until we can return to enjoy the wonderful gift of life at Manor House that you have given to us all. Lord, be with those who are struggling with any kind of circumstance, health circumstance now, and let them know your love, your spirit, and the love of all their friends and fellow residents here at Manor House. We raise them all up before you in our hearts, even though we cannot name them by name. We raise them all up to you in our hearts and ask you to be with them and meet us at our point of need as well in all our unspoken needs and prayers, which you know. The God who sees in secret, you see it all and you know it all. We raise it all to you, O Lord, and to receive your providence, your compassion, and your forgiveness. All this we pray in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, who has taught us this way. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Jesus, keep me near the cross, there a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. I think I did that in the wrong key. I think I'm going to change keys for a second. Yeah, okay, second verse, here we go.
Near the cross, a trembling soul, love and mercy found me. There the bright and morning star sheds its beams around me. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river.
That's better, right?
Near the cross, O Lamb of God, bring its scenes before me. Help me walk from day to day with its shadow o'er me. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross I'll watch and wait, hoping, trusting ever, till I reach the golden strand just beyond the river. In the cross, be my glory ever, your soul shall find rest beyond the river.
And now go in peace, and may Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless you and keep you in his love and care now and forever. Amen. Ah.